गुड इवनिंग ऑल। सो टुडे वेलकम टू वन मोर सेशन ऑफ ESP ICM। टुडे विल बी हैविंग ए वॉक थ्रू थ्रू द लेटेस्ट सेप्सिस गाइडलाइंस। व्हेन एवर यू टॉक अबाउट इमरजेंसी एंड ICU, यू कैन नॉट सेपरेट सेप्सिस फ्रॉम दीज टू डिपार्टमेंट्स। ऑलवेज व्हेन एवर यू टॉक अबाउट इमरजेंसी और ICU, सेप्सिस इज एन इंटीग्रल पार्ट ऑफ दिस। मोर एंड मोर पेशेंट्स यू आर डीलिंग in your ICUs or emergency regarding sepsis. So in 2016 there was a major update on the sepsis guidelines, and now in 2021 we have come across new updated version of the sepsis guidelines. So they have made changes on 93 points. Some recommendations they have retained the same, on some they have downgraded, and on some they have upgraded. So we'll quickly go through all these changes and recommendations so that we can get an idea what has changed in 2021 guidelines. So these are the Surviving Sepsis Campaign International Guidelines for Management of Sepsis and Septic Shock 2021, this call up, and these are from European Society of Intensive Care and Society of Critical Care Medicine. But before going to these guidelines, I would like to mention one more very important point. Just go up. They have clearly mentioned, just one more. They have clearly mentioned the recommendation in this document are intended to provide guidance for the clinician caring for the adult patient with sepsis or septic shock in the hospital at settings. They are just guidelines. Recommendation from these guidelines cannot replace the clinical decision making capability when presented with a unique patient's clinical variables. So again, these guidelines specifically they are saying, these are just the guidelines. Your clinical judgment at the bedside of the patient matters the most. That's what we are teaching in our society, whose name is ESBICM, Educational Society of Bedside Intensive Care Medicine. So at the bedside, you are the best judge to take the decision, and these guidelines will help you. Now we'll quickly jump to the table. There are 93 points. We'll go through them one by one. So these are table of recommendation. It starts from 1, 2, 3. Like this, you have 93 points. So how they have mentioned, anything written in blue, anything with a background of blue, you must not be seeing clearly on this projector, but anything written in blue with a background blue means there is some change in that. Anything without a background of blue, that means they have retained the same thing. So in different categories, we'll decide. Here is the recommendation change. Here is the recommendation. If it is a green, double exclamation, strong recommendation, single exclamation, weak recommendation. Red, double exclamation means strong against, single exclamation, weak against. If it is question mark in gray, that means they are not sure what to do in this. They can't recommend anything. And with a star mark, blue star mark, it means they have the best recommended practice. It should be done. This row shows you a level of evidence, moderate, weak, low, strong evidence, what level of evidence they have given that recommendation or suggestion. So we'll quickly go through. Now, here we'll start another heading, screening for patient with sepsis and septic shock. So how will you screen the patient? There is a change in the statement. In 2016, what they recommended that the hospital system should have a performance improvement program for sepsis, including sepsis screening for acutely ill and high-risk patient. Now they have included that they should also include standard operating procedures for the treatment. Means all your patients, all your treating patients who have SOPs should also be screened for sepsis, like routine surgeries and all those things. Any patient, it should be standing operating procedure so that you can pick more and more cases of sepsis. Second, they recommend against Q-SOFA score compared to SIRS, NEWS and MUSE or a single screening tool for septic and septic shock. In 2016, also there was Q-SOFA score. Q-SOFA means quick sequential organ failing assessment score was there. It was dependent on three clinical parameters: respiratory rate, your heart rate, and neurological status. Based on these three clinical findings, either of the two are positive, you you had a probability that this patient can have sepsis or not sepsis. Suppose patient is having hypotension, or the patient is having tachypneic, or the patient having altered mentation. So if either of the two were positive, you may think that this patient can have sepsis. But why they are not recommending as a screening tool? As a screening means you have a call in the ward, you go there, you screen on the basis of qSOFA, but they are recommending against that qSOFA should not be as a screening tool. What they found that qSOFA is good for predicting the mortality and long stay in the ICUs, but they are not helpful in picking up. Means it is specific for sepsis but not sensitive for sepsis. If a patient is of sepsis, qSOFA will pick, okay, if these things are there in this patient may have a longer stay or outcome is not so good. But they will not pick a patient whether this patient is suffering from sepsis or not sepsis. So as a screening tool, they are against the use of qSOFA compared to this SIRS, NEWS and MuSCOR. You can use them. So qSOFA should not be used as a screening tool. Third, for adults suspecting of sepsis, we suggest measuring of the blood lactate. They have a recommendation for that. You can use lactate for you should you can have lactate as a screening tool. Actually, what they found that all those patients who were of proven sepsis, lactate levels were closely related with outcome, mortality outcome. So at times there is a confusion whether this patient is having sepsis or not sepsis. So they told that if you have a doubt, if you are suspecting that this patient can have sepsis or not sepsis, you do a lactate level. If the lactate levels are high, there is a high chance that this patient may be suffering from from sepsis. But having said that, only lactate levels is not a good tool to screen the patients. You cannot rely just on the lactate level. There can be multiple causes of increased level. Suppose a patient is of liver failure. If it's a decompensated liver failure, lactate levels may be high. So simply, if a patient is dehydrated or acute gastroenteritis and the patient is in a shock, but it's not due to sepsis, due to hypovolemic shock, due to lactic acidosis, there can be increased lactate level. So lactate level should always be used in accordance with your clinical judgment. But as a single marker, it's not very useful, but definitely it will help you in picking up those patients. So now initial resuscitation. That was regarding the screening for sepsis. Now initial resuscitation. Initial resuscitation means you will have two scenarios. One, in the emergency or in the ICU, either you will have a patient of proven sepsis, or you will have a patient of probable sepsis, or you will have a patient of possible sepsis. Proven sepsis and probable sepsis means there is high chances that this patient is of sepsis. Possible sepsis that this patient may or may not have sepsis at the time when you are evaluating. So let's see. You can see this is a blue star mark. That means it's a best practice. You should do this. They strongly recommend. This document is available freely. We'll give the download link in the description box. You can review. For those it is not very clear, you can review this. And it's a good document. In each point is elaborated in detail. And why the recommendation was given, why not the recommendation was given, they have given under the heading of rational. Means what was their practical approach on which they have given this recommendation. Now, initial resuscitation. They are telling that sepsis and septic shock are medical emergencies, and we recommend that treatment resuscitation should begin immediately. Means your treatment means your antibiotics, and resuscitation means fluid resuscitation, which we consider it should begin immediately. You should not wait. Like stroke, like MI, sepsis is also a medical emergency, and treatment resuscitation should begin simultaneously. Now you can see that there is a blue change, there is a change. This 2016 statement, and there is an arrow. It means they have downgraded the recommendation. What they initially in 2016, what they recommended that the initial resuscitation for sepsis-induced hypoperfusion, at least 30 mL per kg of intravenous crystalloid fluid should be given within the first 3 hours. In 2016, they were of the opinion that whenever you suspect a patient of sepsis and the patient is in shock, 30 mL per kg of the crystalloid fluid should be given. It was recommendation. But now they suggest. It has come to suggestion. Means recommendation, difference between recommendation and suggestion is, recommendation means it should be done. We recommend that this should be done. Suggestion means that we suggest that you can do this. Now, doing this or not doing this depends upon your clinical judgment. So, flu resuscitation of 30 ml per kg body weight within the first 3 hours was a recommendation. Now, it has changed into a suggestion. Means, if you feel that this much fluid is not required for the patient, you may increase or decrease that fluid, but fluid should be given. That is important. Now, for patient with septic and septic shock, we suggest the dynamic measure to guide the resuscitation over physical examination or static parameters alone. Means, dynamic measures means simply physical examination won't help you. You should help other markers, tachycardia, what is the BP. It's a dynamic measure. Suppose just giving 1 liter of fluid brings your BP up and decreases the heart rate by 20-30 per minute. So you can decrease the rate. So it's a dynamic process. It's not a static process. Okay, this should be done. This much should be done. No, it's a dynamic process. Suppose your patient is landing in failure, you should stop the fluid. If your patient is responding, you can adjust the fluid. That's a dynamic process. No change in that. Now, for patient with sepsis and septic, we suggest guiding resuscitation to decrease serum lactate in patient with elevated lactate over not using serum lactate. So, you should do a lactate level. Usually, it's there in your blood gas, ABG. But you should measure the lactate. Lactate is a very good marker. If your patient has a lactate level of rising on admission, if in 24 hours it decreases to a certain value, it has got a good prognostic value. So you should chase lactate levels, and it should help you in guiding resuscitation. Suppose you have given the fluids and all those things, and after 4 hours, 6 hours, your lactate start decreasing, that means it's a good marker. But if your lactates are not in decreasing, that means something needs to be done more. It will help you in guiding. For now, they have included this one. This is a new thing. For adults with septic shock, we suggest capillary refill time. Earlier, the capillary refill time was used to be done in kids only. You compress the certain aspects, dorsum of the hand, chest, capillary sternum. You can see capillary refill time to guide resuscitation as an adjunct to other measures of perfusion. You should use. Now, this we are doing at our own for many years. Whenever you examine the patient, you feel that the patient is cold and calming. And whenever we are pressing it, the capillary refill time is increased. So we were doing this clinically. But now they have come up with a suggestion on this, that you can use capillary refill time as an adjunct. Means you can add this parameter also in resuscitating the sepsis patients. Mean arterial pressure. Moderate, strong recommendation for how much mean arterial pressure you should maintain. For patient with septic shock on vasopressor, we recommend an initial target mean pressure of 65 mmHg over higher MAP targets. So, mean arterial pressure should be above 65. Basically, this question arises and asked by, to me a lot of times. Suppose the patient is hypertensive. The patient remains hypertensive. So whether in that particular patients, we should keep a MAP a little bit higher up to 70, 75, 80, 85. So these societies took that part also in their consideration. So in certain patients, they increase the MAP to a particular level between 80 to 85, 70 to 80. And in some patients, they capped it between 65 to 70. So in those patients who were chronic, who were having hypertension for a longer time, the chances of renal replacement therapy was a little bit decreased. If they keep a mean arterial pressure a little bit high, the chances of going this patient on dialysis or renal replacement therapy were a little bit low. But when they compared the overall mortality, there was no difference. So it may happen that if your patient is a hypertensive, if you keep a mean arterial pressure a little higher level, 70, 75, 80, there are chances this patient may not land in dialysis. There are chances. But if you compare the overall mortality, it will make no change. So what they said that at least you should keep the target above 65. Even if you are able to keep the target above 65, the perfusion to the organs will be maintained. Whether or not patient will require dialysis or not dialysis, that is a different issue. You can put the patient on sled or anything else. But the mortality will be same. Means chances of survival will be same even if you keep the blood pressure, mean arterial pressure above 65. Got this point? This is very clear. So there are chances if you keep the MAP little bit high, your renal perfusion or chance of dialysis will be decreased, but there will be no impact on the mortality, survival. So keeping above 65 is a good enough target. Now, admission to intensive care. When the patient should be admitted to intensive care. So for sepsis and septic patient who require ICU admission, we suggest that this patient should be admitted within 6 hours. Suppose you feel that this patient requires an ICU. So if your bed is available, if your bed is not available, if your bed is available, okay, move to the patient to the ICU within 6 hours. If bed is not available, try to make him shift to an ICU within 6 hours, because intensive care, lots of things to be done in the ICU. So don't keep the patient waiting in the emergency or in the ward for a longer period of time. Even in the ward, you feel that this patient is of sepsis, shift, and you feel that this patient requires an ICU admission, shift within the 6 hours. So this was the recommendation. Okay. Infection. Best practice. For patient with suspected sepsis or septic shock, but unconfirmed infection. You don't know where is the infection. We recommend continuously reevaluating and searching for the alternative diagnosis and discontinuing empirical antibiotics if an alternate cause of the illness demonstrated or strongly suspected. They say that if you feel you are suspecting sepsis, but you are not able to identify the source. So you should continuously search for it. And if you are not able to identify the source, then you should consider de-escalating of the antibiotics. So this was the point. They strongly recommend this. Now, there is a change in this statement. You can see the blue mark. For adults with possible septic shock or a high likelihood of sepsis, in which you feel that this patient is of sepsis or a high likelihood of sepsis, we recommend administering antimicrobials immediately, ideally within 1 hour of recuperation. In those patients, in which you feel this is a sepsis or probable sepsis, give antibiotics within 1 hour. So in septic shock, there is a low evidence, but in septic sepsis without shock, there is a very low evidence. So giving antibiotics within 1 hour, they are recommending, but the quality of evidence is low, but we'll give. In 2016, what they were recommending antimicrobials should be initiated as soon as possible after recognition and within 1 hour for both septic shock and sepsis without shock. Here they were saying after recognition. Here they are saying you are having a high likelihood of sepsis. Here you have recognized that this patient is having sepsis. Here you are seeing that there is a high likelihood of sepsis. So even if it is not confirmed, you give the antibiotics. Now this is the best statement. For adults with sepsis without shock, means patient is in sepsis but shock is not there, MAP, BP is there. We recommend rapid assessment of the likelihood of infection versus non-infectious cause of acute illness. So what they are trying to say is, if you suspect a patient of sepsis but BP is normal, you should always think of other diagnosis. That's what. Now this is change. For patient with sepsis without shock, we suggest a time-limited course of rapid investigation. If concern of infection persists, the administration of antimicrobials within 3 hours from the time of sepsis within recommended. Now in this, earlier they said that if you have a high suspicion of sepsis or confirmed sepsis, give antibiotics within 1 hour. But in one patient, you are suspecting that it is a possible case of sepsis, so search for an alternate cause. But if you are not able to identify even the alternate cause, give antibiotics at least within 3 hours. Don't delay. At least within 3 hours, you should give it. Earlier, they were recommending within 1 hour, but they are now giving time. If you are not suspecting this is sepsis, you should at least search for alternative diagnosis and give within 3 hours. Then you can give up, you can stretch your assessment up to 3 hours. This was without, for patient without shock. Means your BP should be stable. If your BP is not stable, then you should give within 1 hour. Means probable sepsis, possible sepsis with shock within 1 hour. Possible sepsis without shock, alternative diagnosis could be there. You can wait up to 3 hours. Now, again, patient with a low likelihood of infection or without shock, we suggest deferring the antimicrobials while continuing to closely monitor the patient. Earlier, there was a recommendation you should give antibiotics. Now, because of the antibiotic resistance and other side effects of antibiotic, they are seeing that those patients who have low likelihood of sepsis, low likelihood of infection without shock, you should defer giving antibiotics up to 3 hours. Okay. For adults with suspected sepsis or septic shock, we suggest against using procalcitonin plus clinical evaluation to decide when to start antibacterial as compared to clinical evaluation alone. This is a very, very, very important point. Earlier, what used to happen? If you suspect patient with sepsis or septic shock, then you what used to be clinically you are suspecting that this is sepsis, but you are in doubt. You send procalcitonin, and suppose procalcitonin comes negative, so this is not the sepsis, will not give antibiotics. So what they are saying is they are against using procalcitonin and clinical evaluation to decide when to start antimicrobial as compared to clinical evaluation. Your clinical judgment stands on priority. Procalcitonin levels can be low, can be normal in sepsis. Procalcitonin levels are usually high in your gram-negative sepsis. They are not high in your gram-positive. They are not high in tuberculosis. They are not high in fungal. They are not high in the viral. So procalcitonin level can be normal. So don't rely on procalcitonin level alone to judge whether this we should give antibiotics or not antibiotics. This point is very clear. In sepsis, along with your clinical evaluation, don't rely on procalcitonin too much to decide when to start the antibiotics. This point I'm able to make it clear. So this is very important. Okay. So your clinical judgment is very important. Now MRSA. If you are suspecting a septic shock with a patient in which you are suspecting MRSA is there, you should cover MRSA in your antimicrobials. So they recommend you should give you should cover MRSA in which you are suspecting that this could be due to MRSA. So in 2016, they were giving empirical broad spectrum. Okay? There was no mention of MRSA. They were there to cover all likely pathogen, including bacterial fungal coverage. But they have given specifically if you are suspecting MRSA, you should give antibiotics, cover antibiotic MRSA. But in those patients who are low risk of MRSA, we are against using empirical antimicrobials with MRSA coverage as compared to using antimicrobials. So if you are not suspecting MRSA, if it is suppose you have intra-abdominal inspection, you are suspecting gram-negative sepsis, suppose you are suspecting complicated UTI in which gram-negative sepsis is likely. So if you are suspecting gram-negative sepsis, they don't force you to give teicoplanin, vancomycin, linezolid, or anything for gram-MSA in this patient because it increases the resistance. So don't use it empirically if you are not suspecting. Definitely, if you are suspecting, it could be MRSA. If your local isoflora says that it is high possibility is there, definitely go for it. But if your suspicion is low, don't go. This point is very important. For patient with sepsis or septic shock and high risk of multi-drug resistant organisms, in patients, if you are suspecting it's a multi-drug resistant organism, then they suggest using two antimicrobials with gram-negative coverage for empirical treatment over 1 gram-negative agent. This point is very clear. So if you are suspecting gram-negative sepsis, you should use two antimicrobials to hit that organism because mortality from gram-negative sepsis is very high. So that's why we use a combination. And preferably, those two antibiotics should be two different classes. One should be acting on the bacterial cell wall, one should be acting on the nucleus or can be on the proteins. So they should have different mechanism of action that this gives a better coverage. So if you are suspecting gram-negative sepsis, you should hit with two organisms, two antibiotics. Okay. And in those who are low risk of multi-drug resistant gram-negative, they are against using two antimicrobials. You just use one antibiotic which covers gram-negative sepsis. So how you will suspect, there is a literature there with them, but patient is deteriorating fast, there is a multiple comorbid conditions, have received antibiotic previously also, diabetic. So these are high risk of developing gram-negative sepsis. So two antibiotics if you are suspecting gram-negative sepsis. Now suppose your culture also comes. What they're saying? For adults with sepsis and septic shock, we suggest against using double gram-negative coverage once the causative pathogen and the susceptibilities are known. Suppose you have a culture report in which you have an organism and you have a report that this patient is susceptible to this thing. So don't use two antibiotics. Mind you, in many reports you will be see that it is only sensitive to colistin. That is a different scenario in which you need to combine it with one other synergistic antibiotic so that it doesn't develop resistance in same particular patient. But if it's sensitive to multiple drugs, so you don't give two antibiotics, just give one antibiotic for covering the gram-negative pathogen when your culture report is there. Regarding fungal and virus, so if it is a high risk of fungal infection, you add it antifungal, and if it is low risk of fungal infection, don't use it. So that's what we are following. If we suspect that this could be a fungal infection, you definitely go for it. And if you are not, then you can. Same applies to antiviral. Now there is a question mark on antiviral. So they have left to us. If you are suspecting viral, you can add it. If you are not suspecting viral infection, you don't add it. They can't make any recommendations. There is a question mark, you know. Now this is very, very important thing. They are suggesting prolonged infusion of beta-lactamase for maintenance after the initial bolus over the conventional bolus infusion, like carbapenems, beta-lactams, antibiotics. You should give the bolus and then give the continuous infusion. Like meropenem should be given over 3-4 hours. Beta-lactam should be given. So it depends on the PK/PD of the drug. So I think we should follow also that. In some patient we are following, but it should be a routine. You just give the bolus dose of any beta-lactam, carbapenem, and then the next dose should be given over infusion of 2-3 hours, है ना? At least 2 to 3 hours it should be given. And they that's why there is a table also in this document where they are saying that we recommend optimizing the dosing strategy for antimicrobial on the accepted pharmacokinetic and PK/PD of the drugs. Some are time dependent, some are concentration dependent. So like amikacin, you should give one strong single shot dose. It is not time dependent, it's concentration dependent. So it should not be 500 BD, it should be 1 gram OD, like that. Carbapenems, beta-lactamase, they are time dependent. Give 8 hourly over infusion of 2-3 hours, like that. Okay, this was about antimicrobials and antibiotics. Okay, now they recommend rapidly identifying and excluding the anatomical diagnosis. Means they are saying you should try to identify the source, and if you require any source control, then you should do an intervention medically or logistically practical anyway. Suppose there is an abscess, you should drain it out. Suppose there is interabdominal thing, intussusception or some surgery is required, do it. If there is a necrotizing fasciitis, you should operate. If whatever it is required, you should do it. Also, regarding removal of the central lines, they strongly recommend that you should prompt removal of intravascular access devices that are a possible source of sepsis or septic shock after other vascular access has been established. Once your access is established, you take another line and remove it. If a central line in place, remove it. If you have Foley's catheter, remove it, like that also. Intravascular devices. Intravascular devices. It's not regarding police. And what should be the duration of the therapy? Whether it should be 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, 6 days, 7 days. So earlier we will come to this, that shorter, they are suggesting that shorter duration is better over longer duration. They compared giving antibiotic to 5 days, 10 days, 14 days, and they come up that giving for shorter duration of period is as good as giving antibiotics to for longer period. So usually the antibiotic response comes in 2-3 days, and if your antibiotics is working, then shorter duration of antibiotics required. But what they are saying here, you should suggest daily assessment. It's not that you start today and you will review it after 3-4 days. No, you should daily assess whether our antibiotic is working or not working, whether we need to change it, we need to add it or do it. So they are suggesting it should be a daily assessment. Now, this again, earlier we have discussed that procalcitonin should not be used along with clinical judgment for the initiation of antimicrobials. But what they are saying is, for adults with initial diagnosis of sepsis and septic shock, initial diagnosis was there, and adequate source control where optimal duration of therapy is unclear. We have done everything, but we don't know till how long we should continue the antibiotics. They suggest using procalcitonin and clinical evaluation to decide when to discontinue antimicrobials over clinical evaluation alone. So this is difference. for the initiation of antimicrobials, procalcitonin has got no value. You start it on clinical judgment. But now you have started, your patient is improving, and now you are confused when to stop it. So they are saying that along with clinical judgment, you should add procalcitonin. If your procalcitonin levels are normal, you can consider discontinuing antibiotics. So that's a catch. Okay. Hemodynamic management. So this was about antimicrobials, antifungals, antivirus. Hemodynamic management. So what fluid they are giving? Simple. It's same. They are recommending crystalloid for fluid resuscitation. Simple. You should crystalloid. Over colloids, crystalloid is recommended. Now, this is a change from 2016. Earlier, they are suggesting that either balanced crystalloid or saline. So balanced solutions are those which contain low level of chloride. There are many brands available. So those are the balanced solutions which contain certain amount of different electrolytes, and there are low levels of chloride. So in 2016, they were suggesting either balanced crystalloid or saline for fluid resuscitation. Now they have changed it. What they are saying, we suggest using balanced crystalloid instead of normal saline for resuscitation. So for initial resuscitation, you should use balanced solutions rather than normal saline. I also came across this right now also. So what this will help give you, why they are recommending that, it decreases the chances of hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, decreases the chances of AKI, decreases the chances of certain inflammatory parameter markers to be released. So for fluid resuscitation, they are recommending balanced solution rather than normal saline. This is a big change here. But the quality of evidence is low, but the recommendation is high enough. Okay. For patient with septic shocks, in which those who have received large amount of crystalloid, you are given lots of fluids, lots of balanced solution. Even if you are not picking up the patient, you should use albumin. That's what we are doing. We suggest using albumin in patient who receive large amount of crystalloids. Okay. They are against using starches. Hexathiol starch should not be used in such patient. They are also against gelatin for resuscitation. Gelatin should not be used. This is very, very interesting and very, very important. Which vasopressors to be used? Which inotrope to be used? Well, very, very fantastically, they have clarified all the things in this. I think this is the most accurate thing they have given in this guideline. Now, for adult with septic shock, we recommend using norepinephrine as the first line over other vasopressors. So start noradrenaline. Norepinephrine is still the first choice. Whenever you have a patient of sepsis, start with noradrenaline. Now, patient with septic shock on non-epinephrine with adequate MAP. You have given the fluids, you started the noradrenaline. Now, you are not able to maintain the MAP. So, next, what you should add? They suggest adding vasopressin instead of escalating the dose of epinephrine, which we have seen that it gives a good result. So, after noradrenaline, the second best thing to add to that is vasopressin. Earlier, it was not there, but vasopressin is a good choice. First noradrenaline, secondly vasopressin. Now, in which you have taken non-epinephrine and vasopressin also. So what should be the third one? We suggest adding adrenaline, epinephrine. Noradrenaline, vasopressin, then adrenaline. And they are against the use of terlipressin. Okay. Now you have a patient of cardiac dysfunction. Suppose this patient has cardiac dysfunction. Patient with septic shock and cardiac dysfunction. Very important. With persistent hyperperfusion despite adequate volume status and arterial blood pressure, we suggest either using adding dobutamine to norepinephrine or using epinephrine alone. So, but if you have a sepsis patient who is also a cardiac patient, so you can start with either norepinephrine and dopamine, not vasopressin. Vasopressin will not be the second choice along with noradrenaline in cardiac patient. So if you have a cardiac patient, you start with noradrenaline and add dobutamine. Or you can go straight away with adrenaline. That's it, the recommendation. Very, very interesting. Now, for patient with septic shock and cardiac dysfunction with persistent hypoperfusion, despite adequate volume status and arterial blood pressure, we suggest using levosimendan. It should not be used. Levosimendan is not recommended for cardiac patients. it came to increase the cardiac output, but in sepsis it should not be used. Okay, and you should always have invasive monitoring of arterial blood pressure over non-invasive as soon as practical. Whenever possible, take an artery line. Now, for patient, this is very important. Earlier there was a concept that you should resuscitate the patient fully with fluid and then start your vasopressors. Now they are saying is this. So just starting vasopressors peripherally to restore mean arterial pressure rather than delaying the initiation until a central line is secured. This is what we are doing for so many years. We take an extra jugular or take a cannula of 18 or 60 and we start noradrenaline with that. And then we take a central SS and start. So that's what we are saying. You, when you have a patient, give fluids, start vasopressors, take a peripheral line. And preferably peripheral line should be taken near the cubital fossa. They have given this. Okay. Now they are unclear on this. There is insufficient evidence to make the recommendation use of restrictive versus liberal fluid strategies. Some say that you should give lots amounts of fluid, 30 ml per kg body weight. Some say you should restrict the fluid so that the patient doesn't fill up or develop fluid overload. So they are not commenting on anything on this. It's your clinical judgment which decide whether how much fluid should be given to the patient. Give the fluid, monitor dynamically and that. But there is no fixed pattern, fixed quantity which should be given. Okay, this is change. Okay, so ventilation, we recommendation on the use of conservative oxygen targets in adults with sepsis and respiratory failure. Means those patients who are hypoxia, having chest infection also, pneumonia patient. So some say that you should maintain a saturation of about 90, 92. You should not chase for 95, 98 like that. So they have said that we don't have a sufficient data to say which one is good, whether you should chase the saturation or you should not chase the saturation. It's a clinical, but in a clinic, in practically 91, 92 is fair enough for us SpO2. Now, this evidence has come, this has changed. Instead of BiPAP, those who have hypoxic respiratory failure, instead of BiPAP, they preferred HFNO. High nasal flow oxygen over HFNO they have preferred. Depends, but it's again your clinical judgment, but they have suggested this. The quality of evidence is low. Okay, whether you should intubate the patient or whether you should keep the patient on BiPAP, it's again a question mark. It's again your clinical judgment. Like we have a patient on bed number 9, whether we should intubate the patient or whether we should keep it on the BiPAP, so it's a clinical judgment. They don't have a data to suggest you should intubate early or you should put the patient on the BiPAP trial. No data to suggest that. Now, same, the ARDS strategy remains the same, 6 ml per kg body weight. Okay. Plateau pressure should remain below 30. Fine enough. Higher PEEP over lower PEEP, they suggest. Okay. And low tidal volume should be used in ARDS. This remains the same. Okay. Traditional recruitment measures, they are suspecting. But incremental PEEP therapy should not be used. We can discuss in separate ARDS class. And prone ventilation is suggested by them, which should be 12 hours per daily, means more than 12 hours. You should give prone ventilation to the ARDS patient for more than 12 hours. This is important. Neuromuscular blocking agents like etrasiline or infusions or other neuromuscular blocking agents, they recommend that you should give boluses rather than over continuous infusion. If it's a severe ARDS patient, you are not able to maintain, obviously you need to take the infusion, but recommendation is you should keep intermittent bolus. Sedation is fine, but it could be there. And if you're, in spite of all this, in your severe ARDS, if the therapy fails, they are recommending ECMO. That we know that our institution has also got ECMO. We'll start additional therapies. Okay. This is also important. This is a change in the statement. Earlier, this is regarding steroid. This is important. This is regarding steroid. Earlier, they were against using intravenous hydrocortisone to treat septic shock if adequate fluoresceration vasopressor therapy are able to restore hemodynamic ability. Means you have given the fluids, you have taken vasopressors and mean arterial pressure is maintained. So they were against using steroid. Don't give steroid. If that is not achievable, even after vasopressors and fluids, your MAP is not achievable, then they were suggesting they should use intravenous hydrocortisone at a dose of 200 milligram per day. But now what they are telling, for patient with septic shock and ongoing requirement of vasopressor, they will suggest IV steroid. So if you think you have given fluids and now we have taken the patient vasopressors and now the dose is increasing, your your norepinephrine, vasopressin, adrenaline doses are going up. So you can still add steroid at that stage. You need not wait for them to reach a maximum level and then add. So if there is an ongoing trend of vasopressors, you can add the steroids there. So this is a very important change. So if you feel that today noradrenaline was on 5, now it's up to 15, we have added vasopressin, you can add steroid at that point also. Earlier, we have noradrenaline 20, vasopressin, maximum adrenaline, maximum, then we were adding. They were against a polymyxin B hemoperfusion. It's not antibiotics. This was again blood purifying techniques. Means there was some therapies that you should filter it out the toxins through dialysis. So they were against of this. And they insufficient data for other purification techniques. Here, for adults with sepsis and septic shock, recommend using a restrictive transfusion strategy, blood transfusion. So for most of the patient, hemoglobin above 7 is fine, but three conditions. If the patient is age is over 85 years of age, if the patient is active bleeding or the patient is a cardiac one, you should keep hemoglobin levels at least above 9. So these are the three conditions. Otherwise, 7, 7.5 are fine enough. So restrictive transfusion therapy is there. They are against IVIG. If somebody asks to you in sepsis, we can give immunoglobins. They are against. You should not give immunoglobins. It's a clear cut thing. They suggest against. Okay, for stress ulcer prophylaxis, you should give. We are giving metoprolol infusion. And they are using pharmacological venous thromboembolism prophylaxis, enoxaparin or those are there, unless a contraindication for there. And for patient with sepsis and septic, we recommend using low molecular weight heparin over unfractionated heparin. So whether heparin, low molecular weight, so LMWH is preferred. Okay. If you are using pharmacological venous thromboembolism prevention, like if you have added low molecular weight heparin, you need not add mechanical. So don't put TVT pumps if your patient is already on low molecular weight heparin. Both, don't combine both. This is for the septic patient. So we are following, either we give DVT pump or we use LMWH. And in patient with septic shock and AKI, we use either continuous or intermittent dialysis. That's the recommendation. We have no options. But in patient with septic shock and AKI, where there is no definitive indication for renal replacement therapy, we suggest using renal replacement therapy. So this is important. Suppose you have a patient of septicemia, which is on vasopressors, or after full depression, you are not having any urine output. Patient is developing AKI. So if you have no indication for at that particular time to do dialysis, don't do it. Like there is only two, three, four indication. If the acidosis is persisting for a longer period of time, if there is a hyperkalemia or there is a fluid overload or the patient is uremic. If the patient don't have any these four indications, don't do dialysis. If you have a time, wait for that. Okay. Sugar, how much sugar should you maintain? They should be somewhere around 180. Don't go for very strict control. It should be 150. You maintain a liberal control. Many of the people will come with you in after COVID era that you should give huge amount of vitamin C in high doses. So they are clearly against. We suggest against using vitamin C for in septic patient. Don't give lots and lots of vitamin C. They are against it. There were so many short data studies where they're somewhere saying that vitamin C helps, somewhere saying vitamin C doesn't help. But if you go by these guidelines, they don't help. In some patient, they may help, we don't know. But the guidelines say don't give vitamin C. Regarding soda bicarb, very important. These 2 points cover soda bicarb. Suppose you have a patient of lactic acidosis, means hypoperfusion-induced lactic acidosis. They are against using sodium bicarbonate therapy to improve hemodynamics or to reduce vasopressor requirement. Suppose your patient simply just have lactic acidosis only, but pH is maintained somewhere around 7.25, 7.3. So don't give soda bicarb just to increase the blood pressure. Mean arterial pressure is somewhere around 70. Your acidosis is there, bicarb around 12, 13, and pH is maintained, but you are maintaining MAP. Don't give soda bicarb just to correct the acidosis. But if the patient is having severe metabolic acidemia, pH is less than 7.2, and acute kidney injury also there, means AKI is also there, acidosis is also, then you can use soda bicarbonate therapy. Just to increase the blood pressure, don't give. But if there is an indication of acidosis, severe acidemia, you should give. Okay. Also, nutrition, they should be fed early. and they should feed enterally through the nasogastric feeding or orally. Start as early as possible, but after the hemodynamics have been stabilized, but at least within 72 hours, you should start the nutrition. Okay. We will not go into details of long-term outcomes and goals, because these can be taken care of by reading this document. In this, you need what some points are discussed that you need to discuss with the family, the outcome, the prognosis, and these, there are a good number of points are there. So we are not going to this. You can skip. There was one point was there, which is very important. So this point I need to show you. Whenever you are discharging a patient, this is best practice they have written. Whenever you are discarding the patient from the ICU or from the hospital, they recommend, they are not even suggesting, they recommend reconciling medications. Means nowadays what summaries we get, that the patient was started in higher antibiotics, broad spectrum antibiotics and this. No. You should, whenever you shift the patient from ICU to ward or from the hospital discharge, you should mention on what antibiotics we have given. We have given meropenem, we have given teicoplanin, we have given vancomycin, we have used colistin, we have polymix. So this will help other physicians, other hospital to understand how severe the sickness was, how tough severe was the infection, and to which antibiotics the patient has responded. So this gives an idea. Suppose this patient lands again in some other infection, they will have an idea, okay, last time this was tough, and also side effects of all these drugs. So this point was very important. We recommend reconciling of medications at both ICU and hospital discharge. Okay. Two, three things I would like to show you again. Antibiotic timing, we have discussed this, but just to show you. You have a sepsis which is definite and probable. High chances that this is a probable sepsis or definite sepsis. So whether shock is present or shock is absent, no difference. You should give antimicrobials immediately within 1 hour. No doubt about that. But your sepsis is possible. This patient may be possible. The ER guy said this patient could have sepsis. Right? So if shock is present, you are suspecting that this may have sepsis and there is a BP is low, hypotension. So we will give antibiotics within 1 hour. But you are suspecting this may have sepsis, but BP is also fine. Then you should evaluate for non-infectious causes. But if you are still unsure, give within at least 3 hours. Correct? Okay. Vasoactive agent management, vasopressors. So use norepinephrine as the first line vasopressors. We have discussed this also, but I'll give you a brief. Use norepinephrine as the first line. If central SS is not well, usually they don't have central line. So what? Consider initiating vasopressors peripherally. So peripherally, you can take external jugular or near the cubital fossa. These are good pathways. Now, if cardiac dysfunction persists with hyperperfusion despite adequate blood and volume, then you should, you can either switch to adrenaline, or if you are using noradrenaline already, then you can add dobutamine. In cardiac patients, noradrenaline plus dobuta or adrenaline alone, this can be there. So, but if after noradrenaline also, if MAP is inadequate despite low to moderate dose of norepinephrine, second is vasopressin. Target a MAP of 65 and consider invasive monitoring of arterial blood pressure. This is good. See this. This I wanted to show you. These are the different scenarios: pneumonia, bacteremia, intra-abdominal urinary tract infection. Shorter duration of days means 8 days, 8 days, 3 days, 5 days, and just double. 10 days, 10 days, 14 days, 15 days. But outcome, there was no difference. So that's what they were trying to tell, that if you have sepsis, you have identified the organism, you have hit the antibiotics, keep a shorter duration of therapy. So this was in short about sepsis 2021 guidelines. So I think we have skipped the long-term outcomes part, but there are a good number of points we can go through the document, but at least you should go through the whole document. And it's very, very important that we stick to them. They are going to help us in managing sepsis patient, prevent antibiotic resistance, and make a change in the outcome of the septic patients. Thank you. Any doubt, you can ask in the comments or on the forums. Once again, thank you all for coming.